When an object is moved, we need to do work on it. Mathematically, this can be expressed as work being equal to the force applied multiplied by the displacement of the object. Work is measured in joules, so this energy needs to be supplied by the object that is moving the object. When gravity is considered, gravitational potential energy is defined as the mass of the object multiplied by the height moved and acceleration due to gravity. This equation is suitable to use for objects that move within a constant gravitational field. However, when we think about objects on a larger scale, such as satellites or planets or moons, we cannot use this equation because the value for g will change as we move the object further from the center of mass. When we consider energy in a gravitational field, we think in terms of potential energy. Think of the gravitational potential energy as the potential for an object to fall towards a center of mass. As the gravitational field increases, an object will have less potential to fall because it must be located closer to the center of mass. Consider an artificial satellite. When it is on the surface of the Earth, it is closer to the center of mass and possesses less gravitational potential energy. If we dug a hole to the center of the Earth, it would fall from the surface to the center of the gravitational field, but not as far as it would fall if it were in orbit at a higher altitude. If the satellite is to be lifted into orbit, work has to be done on it. In this case, a rocket may provide the energy or thrust for the satellite to get into orbit. The law of conservation of energy dictates that energy cannot be created or destroyed, only transformed. In this case, the work done on the satellite to lift it into orbit is transformed into increased gravitational potential energy. In summary, if an object is lifted against a gravitational field, work needs to be done on the object. Energy of a falling object is transformed from gravitational potential energy into kinetic or moving energy. Let us put some numbers to the concept. The diagram illustrates an object, in this case an artificial satellite, that possesses gravitational potential energy. On the surface of the Earth, at point Z, close to the center of mass, let's say that the object possesses 10 joules of gravitational potential energy. When the satellite is moved into orbit at point Y, it is further from the center of the gravitational field, and therefore possesses more gravitational potential energy, say 20 joules. When we move the satellite to point X, which is furthest from the Earth, we have a problem. If X is outside the gravitational field of the Earth, it will not fall towards the Earth. If the satellite won't fall towards the Earth, it must have a gravitational potential energy of 0 joules. By definition, gravitational potential energy can only exist within a gravitational field. Technically, gravitational potential energy can never be zero. Even 100 light years away, Earth still theoretically exerts some influence on objects, and this force can be calculated. However, this presents a paradox that needs to be solved. Mathematically, gravitational potential energy is described using negative values. If we revisit the issue at point Z, gravitational potential energy may be minus 20 joules. At point Y, gravitational potential energy may be minus 10 joules. At point X, furthest from the center of mass, gravitational potential energy will be approaching zero. This means that gravitational potential energy is always a negative number. The equation used for gravitational potential energy involves the universal gravitational constant, g 6.672 times 10 to the power of minus 11, multiplied by the masses of both objects in kilograms, divided by the distance between them measured in meters. There is always a negative sign. The distance between the objects is actually the distance between the centers of mass. But because calculations usually involve distances between objects that are vast, the distinction between using the centers of mass or the surfaces is negligible. As an example, let's calculate the gravitational potential energy between Jupiter and its moon Callisto, its outermost large moon. Jupiter has a mass of 1.899 times 10 to the power of 27 kilograms. Callisto's mass is 1.076 times 10 to the power of 23 kilograms, and the distance between them is 1,882,700 kilometers on average. Using the gravitational potential energy equation, substitute in these numbers. Be sure to convert kilometers to meters on the denominator. The gravitational potential energy between Jupiter and Callisto is calculated as minus 7.241 times 10 to the power of 30 joules. No direction is required, as energy is a scalar quantity. This means that this is work done by the system if Callisto was moved from infinity to its current position around Jupiter. It would fall into place, hence no work is done on them, it is done by them. We could also use this equation to determine the change in gravitational potential energy. If Callisto were moved closer to Jupiter, the difference in the gravitational potential energy calculated in its current position and the new position would reveal this. It is worth noting that in the previous example, that the gravitational potential energy determined between Jupiter and Callisto does not incorporate other gravitational influences. Since gravitational potential energy can never be zero, all masses in the universe are theoretically exerting an influence on Jupiter and Callisto. But apart from the Sun, which is a very large mass nearby, and the other large moons of Jupiter, Io, Europa and Ganymede, this force is negligible. You should now have a better understanding of gravitational potential energy and the calculations involved.